I, Ianuali, by the grace of God and under the Constitution of the Hawaiian Kingdom, Queen, do hereby solemnly protest against any and all acts done against myself and the constitutional government of the Hawaiian Kingdom by certain persons claiming to have established the provisional government of and for this kingdom.
That I yield to the superior force of the United States of America, whose Minister Plenipotentiary, His Excellency John L. Stevens, has caused United States troops to be landed at Honolulu and declared that he would support the provisional government.
Now, to avoid any collision of armed forces and perhaps the loss of life, I do this under protest and impelled by said force, yield my authority until such time as the government of the United States shall, upon facts being presented to it, undo the actions of its representatives and reinstate me in the authority which I claim as the constitutional sovereign of the Hawaiian Islands.
Yo.
Yo.
Thank you.
Coming today. In terms of federal recognition right now, what we're looking at, my name is Helen, just gonna introduce myself. Helen Sonora Pali, I'm from Hulio'o. I used to actually teach here. Me and my husband actually fought for this building to be built many years ago. Ka'iu, you remember that too, right? And when we fought for this building, we fought for a place of Waihee Pu'u Honua, where the truth and our Lahui can gather and we can actually grow our Lahui. That was the purpose of it. The work wasn't over when the building was built. That was when the work started. And this was a center for us. And now to have the opposite of the truth being shared here at this center is mina mina for me. Because I grew into an adult here. And this place has a lot of mana, a lot of memories. So I just wanted to share a little bit about the Department of Interior Rural right now. It's in its final stages. The ratification of this constitution is the next step that they're doing. John Waihee Sr., Norma Wong, wrote a grant that they're sending out to Native American tribes across the nation. And this is during the time when Native Americans are worried about their water supply. They're sending out their grant for $2 million to Native American tribes and organizations on the continent so that they can have money to ratify this constitution that was written in 10 days. And it's supposed to represent the Kanaka Maoli people. They're gonna take this constitution, they're gonna ratify it with $2 million and 30,000 Hawaiians. 9,000 of them have to be on homesteads, or they need to be eligible for homestead, yeah. So they're gonna take this constitution, ratify it, send it up to the Department of Interior. Department of Interior will approve it. It's in its final stages, only one nation will be recognized unless we can stop this. And this nation will be the one nation representing all Kanaka Maoli voices. No lands, there's no lands except for Kaho'olawe. We have the right to sue, but the US has immunity, which means nothing. This puppet nation that is funded by the state of Hawaii by Oha monies will settle once and for all the 2 million acres of Hawaiian Kingdom government and crown lands that is rightfully ours as Kanaka Maoli. This is it. They're gonna take our voice away with this constitution that was written in 10 days, with representatives that are unelected. They don't represent us, and it's all going towards the Department of Interior Rule to become a federally recognized Hawaiian tribe. So it's a kaumaha thing that they're doing, spreading their, I believe it's hewa. And we're standing out here trying to be dignified and just mahalo everybody for coming. And I just wanted to share that. But good memories over here, fighting for this building, good memories being in this building. This is where we organize as students. And I'm kind of kaumaha to see how this Hawaiian Studies has changed now. So hopefully it can move it back to the Pono side where it used to be.
Aloha.
Aloha Āina kākou.
Aloha.
So I want to speak a little bit too about how this, more about process, yeah? Because the reality is there's a lot of unknowns. There are some federal recognition supporters who are saying, oh, I support independence too, and that this can be a first step or path towards independence. And then there's a lot of us who have many concerns about what federal recognition implications or impacts could be to independence. The reality is there's a lot of unknowns, and we all have a responsibility to make sure that we leave the strongest legacy and pono pathway for our future descendants. And so what that means is really we gotta be really careful with process. And if we look at this process that created this so-called draft constitution, as Helani said, it was a constitution that was drafted in 10 days behind a locked gate. And that should speak volumes. A big padlock and a big chain on a gate, and some of us got arrested outside that gate. We also want to look at who drafted this constitution. And it was Hawaiian community members who were really just volunteers, self-appointed. There was no vetting process. There was no selection or election by the Lāhui, by those who are going to be affected, to appoint these people. And if you look at the spectrum of people who drafted this constitution, many of them really, I would say, are not qualified in sort of this doing this kind of drafting. Maybe some were, but I think there was a lot of people that didn't really have the grasp and understanding of the implications. One of the important things is, in order to participate in the drafting, and to this very day, in order to continue to participate, you must enroll in this tribal role. And if we understand the history of roles, we know that it's a political agenda. And tribal roles only exist for one thing, and that is for federal recognition. And the history of the roles, as it goes back to the Dawes Act, really existed to dispossess Native Americans, Native peoples from their land and push them into these areas that we now know as reservations. So roles and the Dawes Act have a history of land dispossession. And so that is the starting point for Hawaiians. The starting point is you have to be enrolled in this tribal role. And they will try to tell us that, you know, it was all up to you. You could choose to participate. You know, you chose not to participate. But what they never want to address, the opposition, they never want to address that the process was never on our terms. It was on somebody else's terms. And oftentimes, we don't even know who that somebody else was. Act 195 established this role, State of Hawaii legislation. We don't know exactly who were the drafters. We don't know who made the decision to create a role. And then later on, there's an Act 77 that's created to take a bunch of names from this ambiguous list, 100,000 names, and drop it into this role. And just about everybody who was taken from the Kaui Noa, you know, undesignated, ambiguous, free t-shirt list, gets dropped into now a Native role. So they may try to argue and spin it, but the reality is that can have nothing to do with self-determination if you didn't actively choose to sign up in the role. And that's, to me, the real the root of the arguments that I think that we should be making, is that the process itself has really been a process that's been legislated, manipulated, funded millions and millions of dollars, while us, the majority of the Lāhui, the majority who are voicing dissent and opposition, have really been just grassroots outsiders, so to speak, in our own self-determination. We've been locked out, we've been kept out, we've been arrested, and they've been funded millions and millions of dollars by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. So we really need to really look at this from a real principled point of a position. And sometimes the opposition will try to spin this and say, oh, well, we have a process and a solution. Where's your process? What's your solution to independence? And we need to not be careful to not get up in that trap, to get caught in that trap. Because if somebody asks me, what is my process to get us to independence, my answer will be, I don't have a process. My process is a process of inclusion that us, together, should be strategizing and organizing and developing that. And if we can juxtapose this to our Maori cousins, they have a process right now to develop a constitution. They spent 4 years in their community and had 250 meetings just to get information about what their community wants and what they think should be a principled approach. And included in that process of community meetings was a focus on youth. There was a whole youth contingent for the Maori. And so what they determined was, the outcome was, we need more education. We need to go back into the community and we need to do more education and outreach. And then they have a projection point, I think a timeline that goes out to 2020. And then they have a timeline that says, okay, we shouldn't be developing a constitution until 2040. And they're doing all of this with $250,000 in funding, where there are rumors coming out of the Office of Hawaiian Affairs by their own staff and trustees that over $30 million over the past 15 years has been dumped into really pushing and manipulating for federal recognition. And when we look at that, we need to understand, even as back in 2006, it went to the Congress, the floor of the U.S. Congress, where there was a debate whether they were going to use a cloture vote to force a vote, a cloture process to force a vote whether Hawaiians should be given federal recognition or not. And the fact that this argument made it to the floor of the U.S. Congress with no process, with no input, with no way to verify or document the will of those who are going to be affected, all of us, really speaks volumes to the validity of whether this is a principled process or not. And so what it boils down to is, it boils down to really those who have power and access to funding and political connections, who think they're doing what's right and think they know what's best for the Lāhui, and those of us who are marginalized in the community who are saying, hey, we don't think you should be doing that. We don't think federal recognition is the best thing for us as a people. But that voice never gets counted. That voice is never seen as valid. And if we look at the Department of Interior hearings that came to Hawaii, hearings on every island, hundreds of people showed up. We tracked the numbers, and about 95% of the testimonies were against the DOI rulemaking that would lead us towards federal recognition. So the voice of the people is ignored. It's not heard. And the Department of Interior took all those hundreds of testimonies, thousands really, and basically said they don't meet the criteria for our decision making. And instead, they counted these generic postcards with one box that you check, I support the DOI rules. And we all know that that postcard was a very well-funded, organized campaign just to get a bunch of mailed-in postcards to support this process. But if we understand how self-determination works, I mean, there's not any rules about how it works. But there are good arguments and analysis that nothing could be more self-determining in a moral context, in a just a logic context, than people showing up in person and expressing themselves in person. Yeah? As Aloha Āina Oia Iho, yeah? In person, saying, no, we don't want this. And that has happened since 2000. And there's been a majority opposition to FedRed, and all the voices over the past 17 years have been ignored, shut out, laughed out, marginalized, demonized, and we're left today as a divided Lāhui. And so we need to really challenge with Aloha the way they've handled this process with money and with oligarchy power and access to Washington DC and the decision makers up there, and that kind of power. We need to speak truth to power, we need to resist, we need to maintain our dignity and aloha, and we need to strive really to bring our Lāhui together and to educate each other and educate the other side of the pitfalls of legislated processes of self-determination, the pitfalls of federal recognition, and really the pitfalls of these kinds of divisive tactics that have been employed by the pro-federal recognition side with lots and lots of money. Mahalo.
Right now, the First Nations people, the people of the land, the people of the earth, all over the planet, are in the front lines of every single ecological struggle, every battle, where there is a tide, a dark tide moving forward to destroy the earth, destroy the land, and who is standing against it? It is our brothers or sisters across the planet. And we stand with them. They stood with us. When Mauna Kea was happening, people from all over the world came because they all feel the same thing. They feel the same hurt in their heart of what's happening to our mother. And they also maupopo that we gotta do something about it right now, because you know, scientists are confirming what we already know, that climate change devastation is coming in as early as 5 years. Now, we're not talking about our children's generation or our grandchildren's generation. We're talking up to 5 years. We've already passed the tipping point for carbon emissions, point of no return. We just passed it this year. And there's still, now we have four of those 5 years, we have Trump and his regime in the United States, the greatest consumer, the greatest military arm, the greatest fist holding down peoples throughout the world, not just First Nation peoples, but all peoples. And I just wanted to share something really quickly, because there's a lot of information that's been coming out of Standing Rock, and that's one of the places right now is going to be the big first battle lines. And we just got some really good news at the Medicare's Council. We just found out that Chairman Frazier, who is the chairman for Cheyenne River, has just made a commitment to leasing 25 acres of land on Standing Rock. And everybody will be welcome.
Right.
And people are willing to, if you're there, it's also in this gray area where it's not totally under Morton County jurisdiction, and it's also partially on tribal land, but it's a protected area. And they are going to maintain it, and they're going to support it, and they have welcomed all the protectors who will stand with them, who will stand with the Cheti Shapon, this Council of Seven Fires, because the Cheyenne Nation is one of the councils of seven elders fires. So Standing Rock is one, so they have every right to challenge the treaty in Fort Laramie, because that's treaty land. The land that Dapo is on, that they're trying to build, is on treaty land. So as we support our independence here, we support our relatives all across the planet, standing to protect the mother. Eo, Aloha Āina.
Aloha Āina kākou. I'm Andre Perez from Koloa Kauai. This is my friend Kalama Moku Honu. Both of us have spent time at Standing Rock supporting the struggle against the Dapo and supporting the Standing Sioux in protecting their water. And here's a message, an important message that we want to send to our Native American brothers and sisters. There is a group of Hawaiians who are trying to ask Native American tribes for money to support this unprincipled constitution. A Native Hawaiian constitution that wants to seek federal recognition for Hawaiians, that was drafted in 10 days by a small oligarchy group behind a locked gate. And we want to send a message to our Native American brothers and sisters to not give them that money. Do your research, do your homework, speak and talk to the larger Hawaiian community and find out what's really going on. We do not want this process to be funded by Native American tribes. We're asking all of the tribes to not fund the Native Hawaiian Constitution process.
And I'd like to add that we call upon all tribes to support the Standing Rock of resistance right now, because that is going to be, don't give this money to a select few people that are trying to hijack our independence process. Give it to the people who are standing for true independence for the people. And we support them. And I wanted to also mention that the history behind this, if you want to know, those of you who know us, those of you who understand where we're coming from and how we support you and how we've really been behind you guys 100%, understand that when we try to bring our concerns to this constitutional convention that was happening behind locked gates at a country club, that essentially we, among others, were arrested. They refused to hear our concerns. This is the constitution that they are asking you to give, the money that your people need so badly. So as we stand with you, we ask you, stand with us as well.
Aloha.
Aloha.
Aloha Āina, everyone. This is Ialani Sonora Pale talking to you from Kamakakūokalani Center for Hawaiian Studies at the University of Hawaii. Today we went and we did a protest, a demonstration outside of the classroom where Robin Dana, Michelle Kauhane from Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement is doing a presentation to the Lāhui, to Kanaka Maoli about the Na'i Aupuni Gated 88 Constitution that was written in 10 days by 151 unelected delegates. We were out here for about an hour and a half. We had John Osorio, we had Jamaica Osorio, we had Andre Perez, Kalama Mihail, Kauka Ohu, Wahilani, and Hui Kulike Kako out here. We had Ilima Long, and we said some words, and we also sang some songs. I went in the classroom after our demonstration for a few minutes to listen, and it was very disturbing. I had to leave. What the slide said when I went in was, in 2014, there were angry Hawaiians at the Department of Interior rule hearings in 2014. And there were 5,000 testimonies submitted, which is all a lie. I had to leave because my opu went huli, and I knew it was so heavy, I might kind of lose it, so I had to leave. Bronson was out here harassing us with his camera. We didn't go in there and harass anybody. We were very polite. We did our protest with dignity. All we did was sing songs out here and do a teaching. But Bronson came outside to harass us and started fighting with our members, our Lahui that was out here protesting. It was interesting. We had a couple students came and they told us they got an email saying to go to this meeting. They didn't even know what it was about. We gave them our information and they went in. So everyone who went in, we handed out our information to. We shared what we were here about. It was a pono demonstration. It was maika'i, and I just aloha everyone that came. Everyone who came is aloha aina, and I would stand with them any day of the week. It was maika'i. My heart is kaumaha right now for our people because I was one of the people that helped to fight for this building. And this building was supposed to symbolize the beginning of the organizing of our Lāhui, and now it hulied. Now we have the Na'i Aupuni Constitution in the classroom being taught to Kanaka and to students here at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, which is totally heva. And it makes me kaumaha, you know, aipohaku. That's what we have to do and continue doing, is aipohaku. And holomua, and inui kawai awa awa, because the struggle is, it continues, but we have to, it's not easy. It's not easy standing outside for a building we fought for the Lāhui, and now it's being used in other ways. It's the same thing over and over again. It seems to be everything that we fight for, it gets overturned by Hawaiians that will sell us out down the road. And that makes me very kaumaha. But it's just some mana'o and thoughts about tonight. But hey, I just aloha that Jamaica Osorio. Oh, she's my kai. So good to see young people that can speak so akamai. And I'm hoping, you know, when we do the call out again, more people will come as well. So aloha, aloha everyone out there. Aloha Lāhui Hawaii. And malama pono. Aloha.